ex-Zionite named Daniel Wright, who was the head of, now the head of a research development company in the city, because the machines had found a way to sabotage the Red Pill program that Zion used to wake people up from the Matrix. And they could now basically put a stop to that just by disrupting the Trace program. So Zion went to Daniel Wright. She said, okay, we'll start working on a new pill that they can't hack, which worked out, except she got killed by the machines. And the machines also found that Wright still had direct access to Zion's mainframe. They discovered that access and they inserted a virus into Zion's mainframe. Meanwhile, CypherWright's spy inside Zion blew up Zion's command center. The virus went off, took out the mainframe, and basically Zion's city got wiped out by a massive attack. In Chapter 8.3, Sentinels attacked Zion's crippled city. Everybody had to flee. Commander Locke was missing. Roland, who was a guy in the movies, was promoted to the new commander since Commander Locke was AWOL. Roland's crew member Colt appeared as the new Zion captain and started appearing in events and stuff like that, missions. Another crew member from Roland's crew, Mauser, was noticed by Merovingians, who captured some info feeds from the machines, to be leading Commander Locke through the rubble of the destroyed city. And he was like, okay, where are they going? And Mauser was not in contact with anybody though, so that was kind of a mystery. Nobody knew where Locke was. The machines used the data they captured from Zion's mainframe to hunt down and kill veteran Zion operatives. They have got the Morpheus Simulacrum to actually help them unlock this code I had from the mainframe, which sort of ticked off Zion. Morpheus Simulacrum was basically confused and not sure which side he should take. And actually, I can't remember why he decided to help the machine. Does anybody remember that?
Crypto stopped him.
Oh, yeah. Like, hey man, we used to be pals. Step aside. In Chapter 9.1, at the end of Chapter 8.3, the Merovingian found out that the machines were removing humans from the pod systems alive and doing who knows what with them. Chapter 9.1, a glowing guy appeared in the Barrens and immediately just killed a bunch of agents and stomped off into an alleyway or something. The machine suddenly pulled back their forces in the real, tried to convince this glowing man to leave the Matrix because he was causing all kinds of problems, killing programs and overriding things. The intruder was becoming frustrated because he couldn't find what he was looking for. He wouldn't tell anybody what it was. But he finally went to the machines and he said, give me this biological interface program that I want. And they said, well, there's only one, it's not in the Matrix, and we don't have it. The Merovingian was searching for programs that the intruder might want, but he's like, no, it's not that, it's nothing like that. In Chapter 9.3, a second glowing man appeared named Carline, and he was after the first guy, whose name turned out to be Hellboy. The Morpheus Simulacrum was seen contacting mysterious exile programs in the Barrens. Halborn, who was the first guy who showed up, the glowing man, he learned from the machines that the Oracle had created this program, and he went after the Oracle. The Merovingian said, hey, this guy's going to go whack the Oracle. Okay, I'll help him out. Of course, Zion did not like that, and they were trying to stop him. And the Oracle, meanwhile, who was being sought by this deadly killer, contacted Equinox Neo and the Cypherite separately and gave them each a piece of an encrypted program and told them to keep it safe. At the end of this subchapter, Halborn found the Oracle and he said, give me the program. She said, no, and he killed
her. Who was there with me?
Who was there?
I was at work, dude.
No, I tried to do that one when nobody would find them, although a couple people did, but they didn't. Because I'd been giving out Terminator bits.
Yeah.
And
just took a secret when you said that.
And the way way I had planned this out, and but I had forgotten about this loophole, was that Halborn was going to use his Terminate override to kill the Oracle. It was a program, and you know, you just sort of turn it off. But so I was actually going to use Terminate on her. But to do that, I had to make her vulnerable to Terminate. So if somebody had walked along at that exact moment and used Terminate right before the intruder had used it, they would have got the kill on the Oracle. So I had to like time it, so there was like a split like tenth of a second window where somebody could have done that, but I was like trying to like stun all the operatives nearby before I fired the thing off.
So we all sat there like sweating. Oh no!
Yeah. Fortunately, it was just like a couple noobs who were there and they didn't know what was going on. In chapter 10.1. The Oracle was now dead. Sati, Seraph, and Morpheus Simulacrum vanish. Halborn continues looking for this program, even though his basic real hope of getting at the Oracle is gone. The machines, in a sort of tricky exchange, said, hey, why don't you Cypherites go help him out? And they led him to this exchange between Zion and Equerbis Neo, who was giving Commander Locke over to Zion to take to their new city. Halborn arrives in the middle of this. He's like, this is bad. And he gets out of there, not before Zion had noticed him. They managed to track him down as a result of that. There was also a large attack from machines and Merovingian ships trying to get Commander Locke, who was being transferred. But there was this massive hovercraft battle. Did anybody get that one?
I don't know what time it was.
It was like
6
in the morning for me.
You were the last one alive. Like, I'm not giving up.
But in the end, Plurbus Neo and Zion fought off the hostile ships and managed to get Locke back to the new city.
What would have happened if someone else won that? Like, would it have changed or was it pretty much?
It would have changed.
So
no, not going to elaborate.
So
on
we
that.
Don't want to say
this. So So we are going to have events from the looks of it that, like, depending on the outcome of the players, will actually change the storyline. So
that's the hope. I mean,
it can happen in some way.
You know, I tell people this, and I don't think people believe me, but yeah, every time people interact in a live event, it does affect what's going on. It affects how the story characters react. And even how they grow in their personalities. I mean, you know, a lot of times I start out and these characters are really just sort of, you know, archetypes or but they sort of learn and grow as they interact with people. So really events are very helpful for me in deciding how is this character going to be. You know, like Baron, the Unlimited guy, he's really kind of developed. And there was a recent event with him. And, you know, I knew I wanted to do something with him. But what are you laughing at?
You like that meat wad thing, don't you?
Yeah, what day?
Hey, people beg me to meat wad.
It was so funny because I saw Bay, he put on like combat CT and like every single pill that existed, and I was like, oh no.
But so that kind of thing really, really helps me sort of develop these characters. But yeah, we'll also look for sort of spots in the story where it's a possible turning point for maybe not, you know, all of the story, but a part of it. So yes, definitely Commander Locke could have ended up in somewhere else other than Uzak. But Zion and Corvus Neo carried the day in that battle. Locke got back to the new city. Merovingian, following this remark that Halborn had dropped while he was trying to sort of kiss up to him, found out that there was this zone, what, like 800 miles northwest of the city that the machines had keep away from. They don't have much info on it even, but he stole some topographic maps, and he decided to send some of his sentinels out there to check out what this was. They get out there, led by the general, and they find a data feed that's tapping into this mysterious foreign network called the Oligarch Network. Zion and the second intruder, Carline, succeed in surprising Halborn, hitting him with this code in another live event that jacked him out of the simulation. And at that point, Carline said, okay, my job's done, and he left as well. Kryptos decided he was going to begin researching how to stop these override codes in case those two ever come back. Chapter 10.2, Mauser, who was last seen carrying Locke through the burning Zion City, suddenly appears in the Matrix, which is strange because he never even had Jax. He was never born in the pod system. He was going through hard lines that nobody had known about, and it turned out that these were from an old hardline network that Zion had used before the end of the war. The Merovingian needed to reestablish contact with the general in this distant zone, and he kicked up the storm outside the city to use this ducting. What was it? Troposphere ducting? Is that what it is? To facilitate communication. This sort of also hampered the machine's search. They were trying to find where this Mauser guy was jacking in from. They almost made it. They almost tracked him down. But then Morpheus Simulacrum appeared in their control center and disrupted their search. Mauser stole some data from the Merovingian and disappeared. Missiles wiped out the general in the no-fly zone. Nobody knew where those had come from. And Pluribus Neo discovered a small craft flying away from the city headed north. In Chapter 10.3, which is the last one we completed, the Cypherites found the Merovingian hacking into the Ouroboros Corporation. He had found that this machine, this oligarch network data, was flowing into this corporation in the city. Kryptos captured some of that data to help, that he thinks will help research the override codes. Pluribus Neo discovered that this craft had flown off. They discovered at this launch site that it had some data, and this data turned out to be the same topographic data on the no-fly zone that the Merovingian had stolen. They decided to go after that, which we actually just had the event where the Pluribus Neo's fleet takes off from the no-fly zone. Who was it, that one? You had a pretty good turnout for that one. All you people are like machines and Merovingians, you know? The machines were trying to get the Merovingian out of Ouroboros, and they were concerned that if the Merovingian was poking into this company, which was obviously linked with these guys who could override the simulation, they might become alerted and come back into the Matrix and start wreaking havoc again. Daniel Wright's old company, Wright Research, sued Pandarus Amaranth, which is Brenda Utley's company, for a break-in by Mauser, who had been apparently stealing data from a bunch of places across the city before he disappeared. Brenda Utley helped Zion find out that Mauser had been going around stealing all this data. They were close to finding what they thought would tell him what he had been after, but then Seraph appeared and told them, you know, stop looking. I can't really explain this, but it would be bad if he kept falling out of this. And Merovingian, of course, was not stopped by anybody, and he managed to find the program that Halborn had been searching for inside Ouroboros. And that was the end of 10.3.
You know what, you got a second? You said the general was dead.
Who's dead?
The general?
No.
I thought he was something like hit with a missile or something.
Yeah. Oh, he was his sentinels and stuff got.
Oh, I thought he was actually dead.
No, that like Flood always fantasizes it in the Merovingian missions. He's like, hopefully he's dead.
Oh, well, okay.
He's not actually dead.
I was about to say then, I was like, damn, I didn't know about that one.
No, I like the wrinkly old guys.
You take him out of the pocket suit then?
There's some clipping problems with, like, oh, because he has to be in stoic, and his, like, neck clips back through the collar. That always drove me nuts.
It's like he's wearing
nothing at all. Remember my nice little picture I drew?
That was cute, yeah, but he's actually very fit and in shape.
It shows.
Except for his face. He needs, like, Botox.
Yeah, it's kind of creepy when you catch yourself eating like that.
What else? A big show, come on, you've never heard of that?
Well, this is kind of creepy when a guy like that in skin-tight clothing.
Yeah, but every time I see him, I see him as that cartoon I drew, and it's just gross.
You know, tomorrow I see him, I think of Rambo's Commando, and I see him, I was like, no, that's Rambo's Commando, I don't know. look the same face, like all like sort of wrinkly and looks just like him.
Yeah, I think the general's a fun character. We've been able to take, because the story has developed, you know, that Paul Chadwick was a writer hired by the Wachowskis to carry on the story, and they had this figured out the other day. Up through chapter 72, somewhere like that. It was basically up through Seraph kind of crawling out of the river and whacking Kryptos. Was mostly Paul's story, and since then Paul left and we had to sort of develop and carry on, and so I've been trying to develop these characters that Paul had introduced, like the general Baron was actually a character that Paul had named, I think, and try to create them and let them be shaped by events and turn them into interesting characters inside the game. Of course, people who have just seen the movies will come in and, you know, who's this wrinkly old guy? Who's this white guy with cornrows and glowing eyes, you know? But,
did he leave, like, notes for the story that he, the direction he wanted it to go, or did he just kind of, you both just kind of said, okay, from this point forward, I'm going to do it?
I kind of changed things. I mean, he had some things that we kept and some things we didn't.
Sure.
Like, I think I've talked about some of the things we didn't do before, like, original plan for the kid was that the kid would kill the general. I think the kid would find the last cheat code and become super powerful, kill the general, make up with Kryptos. Sorry, buddy, big mistake.
My bad.
Yeah, it was going to be this big romantic scene, actually, on the Ascension Monument. I'm serious. And they were both going to go back and rejoin Zion.
A bromance.
And then Cypress is just like, oh, but yeah, we don't exist anymore.
Slash hug.
Yeah.
I guess we'll go back to the missions.
And then Veil assumes control.
So, you know, so I wanted to preserve the Pluribus Neo and the Cypherites, and you know, some people are like, why do we even keep them around anymore? Personally, I think they're interesting groups to work with. They're sort of, we don't have critical missions, which is really the main storytelling device we have, which are these weekly missions that come out. How many people bother doing critical missions?
That's
pretty good,
actually.
That's better than I expected.
Well, the IS boosters.
Those IS boosters.
How many people do it just for the IS boosters?
I do them, but I don't need the story. I'm sorry.
Why do you do them?
I don't know. They come up. They all
the top of the list.
I won't lie. I haven't kept up the story after like the truce broke, but I would hear things here and there, and I'd check out things at live events. I just don't know why I stopped reading the critical mission.
But that's the best way, though. I mean, you can't add it, so like, everyone does a critical mission, you're all doing the same ones, you want it. So you only know this specific part of the storyline, that's how it should be. You shouldn't, like, know everything.
Well, Maeve's saying that he doesn't know anything.
And that's not shocking at all, so...
He just wants to PvP, that's fine,
you know, I mean, really, my favorite people are the people who just, like, PvP and can PvP until Doomsday. And, you know, I could be in Mexico not doing anything, and they would keep... I may have to give him shorts to keep him in, but you know, other than that.
I will tell you right now, if you got me a box of shorts in the game, I would do every critical mission over and over again.
I don't want you to in critical missions.
I would read it until my eyes would bleed, and I would still be content, like forever.
What he wants to hear is, if you give me boxers, I won't look at the critical missions, and you can go to Mexico and go on a party.
In fact, I will convince everyone to only PvP so that you can have the rest of your time off. That's what he's looking for.
If that's what you want. I'm an easy man, please.
Make sure it's like a giant mission phase, yes, dude. Yeah, come on, you're making me do all that for a
female. Yes, there are. I've got 1 to 12 for each show, and then he has to try to eat to get his boxes.
Or am I going to have to do, like, Patrick's head into your grind for, like, a pair of boxer shorts?
He's walking on two of them.
Yeah. You're going to have to buy a 10 stats master crate and then delete it.
Now, who here is a Pluribus Neo member or a Cypherite?
Yeah.
Let's do with Cypherite. Who's Pluribus Neo?
Pretty good.
Who's
Cypherite? All do all
count? That's fine. And, well, okay, so Pluribus Neo, why do you people stay in Pluribus Neo even though you don't have your own critical missions exactly? And,
so I'm effective rubbish.
So for me, Pluribus Neo is an interesting group because they don't like Zion. Zion is kind of tied down in a way. They have a large civilian population that they have to protect. They just sort of have a lot of concerns that they have to be thinking about. They are dedicated to maintaining a mainframe database, to doing all these things, whereas Pluribus Neo are just these sort of, you know, jockeys flying around in ships. They can go anywhere they need to go to get away from machines. Now, originally, you remember there was like a mission with Pluribus Neo where they first showed up and they were like code pulsing and killing civilians and all this sort of thing. So there was this period where we didn't quite know what to do with Pluribus Neo because the initial approach was going to be, well, actually it wasn't, but actually I think it was Frog, Highway Crossing Frog, who thought, well, let's see if we can make them these sort of radical pirate guys who just want to wreck the Matrix. But, you know, some people were down with that, but in the main, and so this is sort of where player feedback comes in. On the whole, it seemed to alienate players who were saying these guys are just brutal killers, they're killing all these innocent civilians, which apparently people may get to do in the agency.
Apparently.
But that was sort of awkward, and it was tough PR for EPN. And it was also interesting because the characters that Paul Chadwick had developed for Pluribus Neo, the leaders, the kid and Shimada, who was actually supposed to end up being his girlfriend or something like that, in a later storyline.
Aww.
You
killed her and you brought her right back to life.
Well, Shimada turned out to be a Cypherite spy?
No.
Wait, what?
Yeah, she turned out to be a spy of some kind.
Don't say that.
No, this is what we didn't do.
Oh, no.
She joined with Vale, and then Kryptos went to Zion with the kid.
Is that why
she killed herself? I think she was overcome with remorse, and she killed herself.
Harry Carey with it.
So the kid was going to be there, Shimada's going to be like, I'm leaving for Cypherite, and then be like, big
Titanic
song.
Yeah, the kid became really depressed, and I forget.
But himself.
Yeah.
Is that why she had that blue shirt? It was like an undertone Cypherite thing.
It's sort of, you know, one of the main challenges for the story as we tell it is finding ways to give Pluribus Neo, as well as the Cypherites, unique things to do because we don't have critical missions for them, but I think we can come up with some fun stuff, like we're working on this story that's going to take place outside of the game with the fleet that they just sent out, and we had players make crew members. Low level, all the characters who all came into this event and jacked out at the same time, and they're going to go off on this mission.
Can we go off to a trading card game?
Hey, microtransactions. And then we have the Cypherites. Why are you guys sticking with the Cypherites? Even though they turned out to be puppets and machines.
His mob engine syntax, that's why I'm sorry. You can't pick and choose what the syntax turn out. You're a Cypherite or a machine, you've got to make that choice. And
yeah.
Vault's just a bit annoying, so Cypherite go that way.
Well, another thing I think they do provide is the main conflict, as I see it, in the Matrix is the man-machine conflict. And really, Zion is sort of man and machine.
machines, according to our machines. But then we've got Pluribus Neo and the Cypherites, who are also sort of on the side, but they give us really just another, you can tell the story from another point of view, essentially, and develop ways in which, you know, Pluribus Neo and Zion might be at odds over something, even though they're sort of working for the same goal, which is to free humanity from machine domination, essentially, as well as the Cypherites, who you know want to keep the Matrix around. They think that is help, that without the Matrix, humanity would be in kind of a rough spot. But you know, maybe they aren't too hot on the machines all the time. The machines have done some mean things.
Yeah.
That we can't all get behind. But that gives us another angle on the side which is supporting the Matrix, and but maybe not going along with the entire machine.
I see another splinter organ on fusion.
What?
Another splinter organ on fusion.
From where?
First.
No.
Come on.
Is there an org limit of three in game mechanics?
No.
No, because the fact that we're in the CTS and it's the advanced factory type, which is what Emmanuel's Institute can't have there, that's right, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
There sort of is. I mean, there's a bunch of stuff that is basically built around three
sure.
IDs for and, you know, it's just a lot of static contact in the city. There's the constructs, which have spawn points for just three words. There's also the fact that I can't write that.
I was thinking for missioning, you would consider EPN and Zion as one, but for PvP, when you flag out, they are separate.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I know you know a lot of people would like that. We haven't gone that route. It would be some possibly hazardous work on our part.
Sure.
So
and then all the factions have to grind rep for the new ward.
No, I mean for missioning and everything, you would be
well, no,
a
no,
machine. But when you came out to PvP, you would see like your
well,
your
right,
site.
Right.
You would see
we flag different, but
sure.
We'd actually have to physically belong to a different org.
No, you would still be a machine org.
Well,
the flag would be based on your faction tag.
For example, if I have a
yeah.
Cypherite tag,
right.
And I'm PvPing, it's like, oh crap, I'm getting ganked by machines. Drop faction, I turn into machine by default because I'm
right.
A faction.
I don't want to interrupt, but we are actually almost out of time. I wanted to ask you guys where you maybe see the story going or where you would like it to go. Anybody else? Come on.
I would like to hear more about this kid and Crypto's bromance.
So you're saying I should develop
it? It should happen.
You know what? Yeah.
And then Shabbat should just join in somewhere. I don't think that's
yeah, throw in Mail, too.
Mail looks like a freak in the sack.
That's why I was really interested. Any other story suggestions for us?
City, new city, that where someone else came from. Yeah,
the oligarch.
The oligarch network.
I mean, it just opens a lot more possibilities because there's just so many different things you can take the angle from, you know, it's different people. Maybe someone with RP, like, oh, I'm from this city. No, you're not, you know. It's just like,
look at me, I'm wireframed.
I'm a 6,000 year old.
Dress all in white, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Why don't you make Caroline a girl? Because I always thought that was a girl.
Who?
Caroline.
Really? What makes you think
I
he was a girl?
I thought that was a girl.
Yeah.
I honestly thought that was a girl.
Those were names that Paul came up with.
I thought that was a chick.
And I think he got those from like British, old British cultures or something. Oh no, wait, actually, that's where I got, that's kind of where I got Halborn. The original name for Halborn was Halliburn or something, which was a...
I know,
was a fish
Halliburn?
What?
Halliburton.
It was a play on Halliburton.
Yeah.
I didn't want to stick on that too much. So.
I think we like call him Henry.
Maybe having the Merovingian try to take the corner on the oligarch network since he's
the Merovingian. I think is another. Well, it's another org I have a lot of fun with. People, I always write his set of missions last, so I'm always kind of loopy by that point. And
great.
But the Merovingian is an interesting part of our story, I think, because, you know, there's the man-machine conflict. He's kind of in the middle. Of course, he's a program himself. He doesn't exactly want to see the Matrix go away.
Just stay on the top.
But, yeah, he would like to, you know, stay rich and stay powerful. So he's pretty much willing to do whatever he can. Either way, yeah. And we also just, you know, part of the things the live team was doing with, you know, McCallie and Malfest, he sort of ended up with this crazy cast of characters that drew the General in there and Baron. So that's kind of a fun thing, and there's just a lot of possibilities with him. You know, I had him going around finding out some interesting things about the surface of the Earth, stuff like that. So I think that's a good avenue for us to, you know, because he's supposed to be an information vendor.
Yeah, all he wants is, yeah.
It's a good angle, I think, for me to use to explore really the Matrix world, and like maybe there's some other stuff going on out there that nobody's ever told us about before.
Definitely more coming than Malfus asking.
Or just more.
I thought you were gonna take that another route.
Yeah.
But I'm proud of you.
I've had more than enough perversion for today.
What about Rachel and Sarah Edmonton?
Why was Sarah Edmonton's logged in?
That is kind of a mystery, and like I tried to get out of Paul what he wanted to do with Sarah Edmonton, because she came out from a newspaper clip.
Yeah.
And you know, he never really explained that to me. So I don't know.
But then you brought Rachel in to confuse it more.
Yeah. So I don't
know.
We'll see. What?
You're the big guy now.
I know. I'll keep that in the back of my mind. Part of the problem is that, you know, we are a story that continues every month. And so you can't just be like, hey, you know, Sarah Edmonton's is Neo. Comes in, yeah, kills the architect, you know, rips his heart out. Because then the next month would come along and be like, what happened?
Is there a storyline, or is there a RP reason for the three servers, for the three instances?
Not exactly. I mean, we've sort of had them mentioned in the story before as instances or something like that. You know, it's really just a mechanic, essentially.
I'm just curious how you're going to explain to recursion when you...
recycle recursion for a test server?
Yeah.
How would we RP that?
Hold on, I have a
question.
There you go.
They reallocated the resources
We actually had considered trying to do some kind of storyline when we did the initial server merges, but then we decided, you know, it's just, let's not, in a lot of ways we thought it detracted from the people who really loved their servers and really loved where they came from, and so that's why we changed the names, you know, when we merged down, and it's like, you know, let's just not storyline it. Everybody knows where they're from. We're very happy about that.
I know what we would do. We would pick like a machinist, either from maybe from Syntax Vector or maybe from Recursion, and like have them be the person who ends up destroying Recursion.
I wouldn't choose
Recursion. Hey, me! I like to destroy stuff.
And they would be hated and reviled by Recursionites for the end.
Oh, well, that's me.
The rest of
the You should have tried traits when the Oracle was going to be capped, and then. Told him to head off the tournament. Oh no, this is Greg, sorry. Well, I'm going to send off the tournament. Now everybody would hate him for another reason.
I don't think we need another reason.
I have one more question. Are you going to do like... It's a good question.
Hello.
Like... Hey, you are. I forgot her name, but that one chick who like, took powers, tried to kill these ass and failed.
Now we need to go
Are you ever going to do stuff like that? Like, Recursion does something, and Syntax does something different, and the story progresses from there.
No.
How
do
you
New character.
We actually need to wrap up.
tomorrow at 3. Where we'll break down into things that we weren't planning on talking about again. Okay, that's always does.
What was your motivation for the infection?
We had so many depressing. We had so many depressing and hardcore characters that I wanted to make somebody who was different.
Someone has always
hit
the part.
Yeah.
But you don't seem to like Effie's heart quite as much, and Effie's the best one.
Some people have decided that I am the effectuator.
Yeah.
So I try to maintain a bit of a step back from that because, you know, I don't want people thinking that's the case. Because as you all know, I am not the effectuator.
You make them in your own image.
He is the ideal man. What can you say? All right, we gotta get out of here.
We have one in Houston. They have cousins. It's just like this.
Came out here, we had this thing. We didn't realize how far things were in the desert.